Hi, I'm Avery Davidson.
And I'm Kristen Oakes-White. Thank you for joining us for This Week in Louisiana Agriculture, the only TV show bringing Louisiana farmers and consumers together every week.
Chances are you love beef. I say that because in 2016, the average American ate 55 and a half pounds of beef that year. That's according to the Department of Agriculture.
Galen Iverstein raises cattle in Kentwood, Louisiana, and sells the beef directly to you at his butcher shop in Baton Rouge. He also raises poultry and hogs, and as Twila's Carl Wigger shows us, that's keeping Iverstein very busy.
In Kentwood, Galen Iverstein is enjoying a beautiful morning on the farm. He's here to check on his grass-fed beef cattle, his pasture-raised poultry, and his heritage breed Berkshire hogs. It's not unusual that he's raising these different animals, but the philosophy behind this farm is quite unique.
Yeah, we're producing animals for meat, but our main goal here is building healthy topsoils on our farm.
Those topsoils matter because of the forage they produce. It's the grass that this cattle depends on to live. The better forage this cattle gets means better tasting beef for the consumer.
That's the challenge for us, is keeping really high quality forage in front of our cattle year round.
This crop of hemp is helping with this summer grazing, but it's also preparing his soil for the fall forage.
We're looking for crops that are going to give back to the soil in this time of the year, so we can come back and plant our winter forages behind it without using any fertilizers to get them started.
From day one, Galen's way of marketing his beef, pork, and poultry has been much different from the average farmer.
Everything I've done has gone straight to the consumer, and honestly, if I didn't have that connection, I don't know if I would want to farm. I want to see that product. I'm very proud of what we raise. I want to have control of how it gets to the market and how it's communicated to customers very honestly and get their feedback.
At first, that happened here at the Red Stick Farmers Market in downtown Baton Rouge. But last fall, he took another step closer to the consumer when Iverstein Farms Butcher Shop opened here in the heart of Baton Rouge.
We're a whole animal butcher shop. You know, we bring in whole sides from the farm, so we're dealing with the whole thing. So it's going to generate a lot of variety of cuts.
This variety of cuts allows Galen and his team to really educate the consumers about their products.
It's really important to us to communicate to the customer where things come from, not only the farm-wise, but where it comes from on the animal, so they can kind of get a sense of how to cook it.
Another huge part of them using the entire animal in the shop here are their smoked and cured meats like bacon and sausage.
The demand for those products have come up, so it's allowing us to bring in more animals to keep up with the production of just those products.
The demand is also really high for these Iverstein Farms pork chops.
People come to us with this thing in their mind that a pork chop's gonna be dried and flavorless. So what we're doing is we're raising pigs to have some fat on them, because that's where the flavor is.
In the last year, Galen has seen growth on the farm as well as right here in the shop. But Galen says that that will never affect the quality of products that you'll find through these doors.
We don't want to let the growth dictate to us with the integrity of the product. It always comes down to those core principles of what we do, of building healthy topsoils and getting a healthy product in the hands of the consumer.
One element of Iverstein Family Farms that has been present from the very first year is their pasture-raised holiday turkeys. Now, Galen told me a funny story about that first flock. That year, he raised around 40 turkeys, and he planned to process them all in one day, all by himself. He began at 7 a.m. that day and didn't finish until the next day, around 5 a.m. He swore that he would never raise another turkey. However, because of the demand from his customers, he went back on his word and raised around 200 the next year. Needless to say, his turkeys are a hit year after year. And if you would like to get an Iverstein Farms holiday turkey on your table this fall, the shop will begin taking those orders in October 1st. For more information on how to order yours and learn more about the farm or the shop, head over to our website at twilatv.org. And you guys, I'm a big fan of Galen's food. I eat his steaks and pork chops all the time. And I'm a big fan of his farm up in Kentwood. It's beautiful country. But my goodness, I love going there for lunch. Almost every week I can find myself on one day of the week there for lunch, and the sandwiches are just great.
Chili's not half bad at all.
Chili's good too.
And I don't know if you remember Avery, his first appearance on our show, which was probably about 4 years ago, for the Reporting for Duty with Taylor Fry. He's come a long way since then.
Yeah, he's doubled his operation since I went and did a story there last spring. So I mean, the growth is crazy, and it's fun to watch from I mean, as I've kind of gotten to watch over the last year, you know, he's coming up on 1 year at the shop, you know, and he's been doing this for 6-7 years now. It's been neat to watch the last year how he's grown. It's really cool.
It's always neat to watch that growth. Thank you very much, Carl Wiggers.
Well, while Carl was following the trail of the delicious food at Iverstein's, a group of teachers got a taste of where their food comes from down in Gramercy.
The fast food farm has been teaching people how their favorites are grown for a while now. TWILA's Neil Melanson says this week, teachers from around the state got a chance to learn themselves and find some help in the classroom as well.
Take it.
You expect kids to be having a good time and learning here at the fast food farm in Gramercy. It's what the place was meant to be. Surrounded by the Emil sugarcane fields, the farm was designed to educate youth about agriculture. Today, though, it's the teachers who are here to learn. Farm Bureau's Ag in the Classroom program has brought its teacher workshops here to give them a hands-on experience. It's an open house taste of agriculture, according to State AITC coordinator Linda Danos.
They're going to do a mapping Louisiana agriculture lesson. So all right there, that's a science and social studies lesson they can take back and put to use in their classroom immediately. All of our lesson plans are ready to go. The teacher doesn't have to do any extra work with them.
The farm brings together the old and the new. Originally conceived to show people where the fast food they love comes from, there's a sneaky lesson here about making healthy food choices for yourself, according to the farm's founder, Denise Emil.
You know, a lot of people say, oh, it's time consuming, but it's not. We want them to understand you can have a healthy, balanced diet by eating what you do instead of driving up so quickly to a drive-up, and you can do it in a short period of time.
The farm attracts between 3,000 and 4,000 visitors each year, including 4-H members who use the farm both as a learning tool and a teaching tool. Combining both a wide variety of crops with a natural setting makes a perfect fit.
Teachers have to teach in the classroom, and a lot of times kids think of it as abstract. If teachers can come here, see what it's like firsthand, and they can also bring their kids on tours here. So it's a perfect opportunity for them to learn and bring it to the classroom and then also bring their classroom out here.
This was the first time an Ag in the Classroom workshop was held in a setting like this. Ag in the Classroom teacher workshops are being held across the state right now, and to find out more, you can log on to our website at twilatv.org. Guys, I can't think of a more perfect setting for a workshop than this. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, Denny's Farm won an award from American Farm Bureau. It's just a great, perfect example of how to teach people where their food comes from. And she's got it all set out. And, you know, I talked to Denny about it. She's a sugarcane farmer, she and her husband Scrap. And I'm sure the learning curve was quite steep on raising things like soybeans and sweet potatoes and, you know, shallots. They had all that out there. And that's just not something you see a lot around in the St. James Parish there, but they're doing an incredible job.
What I love about it is how interactive it is and just how much children enjoy being out there, running around. But what was it like seeing teachers?
Well, that was the interesting thing. I think you saw a lot of what's mirrored when parents bring their kids out. You know, the kids are out there to learn, and that's great, but the parents start to pick up things too. And the teachers, you saw that as well, but I think a lot of them were just the wheels were turning as far as bringing their kids out for, you know, field trips out there, and it's just a perfect day. Plus, of course, all the material that they can get for free from Ag in the Classroom. That was an education for them as well.
It's a great resource. Thanks a lot, Neil Melanson.
Well, still to come on TWILA, it's time to make the most of the bountiful rice harvest and stuff some boudin in this month's installment of Feasting on Agriculture.
But first, getting a sweet crop in the ground to enjoy some sweeter rewards. Stay with us. Following a wet summer and Hurricane Harvey, many Louisiana sugarcane farmers were wondering if they would ever get their crop planted.
But as you know, we've had lots of sunshine since then, and as Craig Gautreau shows us, farmers took advantage of the dry weather.
The sun is shining and fields have finally dried out enough for sugarcane farmers to get back to planting their crop. An especially wet summer and Tropical Storm Harvey were threatening to extend the planting season into the harvest. But good weather since Harvey's departure has allowed farmers to get back on track.
Most of our farmers are probably over 50% complete, which is amazing considering just a couple weeks ago we were really in a bind with all the wet weather than Hurricane Harvey.
It's important for growers to finish their planting because some of the mills are opening soon. This earlier opening is being driven by an increase in acreage, and the crop appears to be a big one in terms of cane tonnage.
Meals are going to start a little earlier. They're going to be starting around September 20th in this parish. But it looks like if we can have another good week of weather, most of our farmers are going to be finished planting.
Dane Berard is one of the few cane farmers who plants billets instead of whole stalks. He was forced into planting billets one year because a hurricane had knocked down his plant cane and time was running out. He says there is a learning curve with billet planting.
We learned a lot. We're 2017 right now, so from 2002, you're looking at 15 years, you know? And we learned from a lot of mistakes.
One thing Berard has learned is that billet planting needs a more mature cane stalk, which requires him to wait about a month longer before beginning his planting.
We have ours perfected to that, but because of a 24-inch billet, you have to almost wait till the latter part of August and the month of September to get your eye matured.
Berard said a big advantage of billet planting is he can plant up to 50 acres in a day with a crew consisting of only 6 people. With the LSU Ag Center, this is Craig Gautreau reporting.
When Louisiana's grinding season is in full swing by early October, a total of 11 sugar mills will be processing cane across South Louisiana. Well, this is also the time when Louisiana rice farmers are watching their ratoon crop following their first harvest.
And you know Louisiana rice is a major ingredient in a South Louisiana staple, boudin. In this edition of Feasting on Agriculture, TWILA's A.J. Sabine takes us to Lacombe, where Chef Eric Hunter makes boudin at his restaurant, La Province.
Feasting on Agriculture with A.J. Sabine is brought to you by the Louisiana Crawfish Promotion and Research Board. Louisiana Crawfish, ask before you eat. By the Louisiana Rice Promotion Board, think rice. And by the Louisiana Beef Industry Council, beef, it's what's for dinner.
Hey there folks, I'm A.J. Sabine and welcome to another delicious edition of Feasting on Agriculture. This month, we're at La Provence, located not 7 miles from Mandeville. In terms of farm to table, it doesn't get any more exquisite than this. One of the interesting things about La Provence is that they grow a lot of their food right here on the farm. Joining us now is Chef Eric Hunter.
Howdy.
Chef, how are you?
I'm good.
And what do we have going on right here? I see you got a couple of hogs here. Tell me what's special about these hogs. These are a rare breed, aren't they?
So they are a heritage breed. This guy here is a Mangalitsa. They're a Hungarian breed. Only brought to the States in 2007, actually. And they are lard pigs, prized for their fat content.
Oddly enough, so am I. I'm prized for my lard content.
I wish it was so.
Now, when you bought this restaurant, acreage and all this, do you know what you were getting into with all these Mangalese pigs and honeybees and chickens?
So, kind of. I thought I did until I got here. No, it's, my wife grew up on a dairy farm, so she's got some more experience with raising animals than I do, but we use the bones for, we use every single piece of these animals, which is a big deal for us as well. You know, these guys sacrifice their life to sustain ours, and we respect that, and it's important to us that we utilize everything that they have to offer.
All right, we're now in the kitchen of La Provence, and Chef Eric Hunter is here with us. And Chef, tell us about what's on your mise en place to start with before we make this boudin.
We're gonna be making boudin. So we have here some Louisiana medium grain rice, garlic, celery, bell pepper, onion, a little bit of serrano, some bay leaf, a few spices,
a little chili flake,
a little garlic powder, and here we have our Creole spice. It's proprietary to the restaurant.
Now, Chef, I know you're from Texas, but did you know that a lot of medium grain rice is grown right here in Louisiana?
I was not aware of that before I got here.
Shazam!
But now I know.
Now you know, brother.
So here we have some pork from our Mangalitsas out back.
The ones we met earlier? I hope not the ones we met earlier.
A little quick for that.
Gotcha. Well, you are an amazing chef. That's what I've been told.
That's what they say. I'm just kidding. At least that's what I say in my mind. House-made pickles. This is our house IPA mustard. And some vinegar that we make, serranos and things from the garden.
So is this what we're going to make?
This is the finished product. So we serve
rotating on our sausage and charcuterie board, we'll serve boudin, a couple of different smoked or fresh sausages. So I got a little olive oil here. So we're basically just gonna sear the pork, get a little bit of color on it.
Nothing says I love you like a cast iron skillet. Well, fans of this segment will tell you I rave and rave and rave about cast iron because it's literally the most versatile pan in the kitchen. You can do everything with it.
Indeed. So it's not only versatile, it's superior for a lot of uses. Like, you can braise on the stove top a lot easier than you could with a stainless or metal pan or pot. It holds heat so much better that, and you can cook outdoor with it. I mean, you can cook on coals, like there's just
anything, dude,
so many different applications.
Absolutely.
So we're just gonna get a little color on this, and then I'm gonna cover it with some pork stock. We'll let that simmer until the meat's nice and tender.
Now that's just another layer of flavor, right?
It's another layer of flavor, and then we drain this liquid off of it, and this is what we cook the rice in.
Oh, wow. I cannot imagine how good that is.
After this goes, we'll add the liquid, until the vegetables are tender.
Mm-hmm.
Then we'll strain that off, and then we'll put the rice in that liquid, and then it looks like this, bam.
Nice.
We like for you to be able to identify all the ingredients. That's why we do it by hand.
Plus it's a better mouthfeel, right?
I think so. So, I've had a lot of people tell me how I need to reheat boudin or put boudin together. A lot of people like do it in the microwave or steam it or smoking it. Actually, I like to smoke as well.
You know, I like to smoke the boudin too, but it keeps falling in my lap once the cigarette paper burns off. You know what I mean? So I stopped doing that and actually started putting it in a broiler, and it worked a whole lot better. But speaking of the broiler, it's going to get hot in here, folks. When we get back, we're going to taste this wonderful boudin that Chef Eric Hunter has made at La Provence. Stick around. We'll be right back. Chef, I can't tell you how grateful Stuart and I are for having us here at La Provence. I know you're a new owner. You've been here less than 6 months or so.
Okay.
Tell us about some of the new energy that you brought to this famous, famous restaurant.
The message we're trying to get out, though, is that it's not only for occasions, it's, you know, a neighborhood restaurant. You know, we want people to feel comfortable coming any day of the week. You know, we've got a television in the bar now, which Chef Chris is probably rolling over about. Like, I don't think that would have been okay back in the day, but, you know, the way that the dining landscape has changed in the last 10 years, people want the same level of food and service in a more relaxed atmosphere.
You can't get any better than Louisiana comfort food, boudin blanc, what you see here. Tell us, kind of give us a recap of all of the ingredients that went into this while you cut me a piece of that.
So we start with the pork from our pigs out back. Then we call this our dirty rice boudin because we put a little liver in it. Mm-hmm. We put some pork liver and we add a little bit of pate to it. So it gets the Trinity, classic Louisiana. You know, everything starts with the Trinity here.
Of course.
Some Creole spice, and we use stock from the pig as well to cook the rice in. And so we're building all those flavors the whole time. And the finished product is in a natural casing that we heat in the salamander and some fresh baguette, some house-made pickles, and our IPA mustard that we make here as well.
Well, I'm gonna dive in here while you tell folks about this wonderful, wonderful La Provence 75 here to my left that your lovely wife, Jennifer, made. Tell us about that.
So this is a take on a French 75, which classically is simple syrup and gin. This has got lavender simple syrup, brandy, champagne, and, you know, a twist of lemon and a little bit of fresh lemon juice. So. With the richness and all the thick fattiness in this sausage, that has the effervescence and a little bit of the citrus to cut through that.
Chef Eric, first off, I don't know if you brought enough for yourself, but I'm about to eat all of this. But
help yourself. It's good.
This is absolutely fantastic.
I'm a fan of it. I eat it all the time.
Mm.
So look, La Provence has been here for a long time. You guys are so welcome here in Louisiana, and I appreciate the great effort that you and your wife, Jennifer, have made in keeping La Provence wonderful. Clearly, it reflects in your food. But I want to tell folks, if you guys want to come visit, check out this wonderful restaurant, check out the farm in the back, where do they need to go? You guys have a website. Where do they need to go?
Our website. We do Facebook and social media, but mm-hmm. the website's probably the best avenue. Or just come out. Like, the door's always open. Like, people come and just sit and hang out by the animals and check out the garden and stuff. We have an entrance from the back of the property from the trace. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's here for people to enjoy, you know? I mean, it's be a shame to put all this effort into it and nobody be able to enjoy it.
My friend, that is fantastic. Thank you so much for having us. And folks, if you guys want more information about La Provence or its new ownership, any of the animals grown out here, including chickens and honeybees and hogs, you guys come out. If you guys want more information, come to our website, twilatv.org. That's all from La Provence. Thank you for joining us. We'll see you next time.
Feasting on Agriculture with A.J. Sabine was brought to you by the Louisiana Crawfish Promotion and Research Board. Louisiana Crawfish, ask before you eat. By the Louisiana Rice Promotion Board, think rice. And by the Louisiana Beef Industry Council, beef, it's what's for dinner.
Cotton has certainly been trending online this week, and we're going to show you some of our favorite posts in this week's Trending on Twila.
Many farmers in the South say this is the most beautiful time of the year, cotton harvest season. And I think that I would have to agree because there's nothing that compares to a snow-white field of cotton that's ready to be picked. Cody Beavers posted these photos on Facebook. A beautiful day to kick off harvest season, he said.
Dustin Morris also posted some great cotton picks with the caption, "Some days are just better than others. These kids love playing on top of the big marshmallows. Cute kids, very cute picture."
We saw lots of other great harvest photos and videos this week to add to our Twila Harvest collection. Robbie Dunaway shared this photo a few days ago. Beautiful evening to harvest, and I'd have to agree with him. Very nice photo. Thomas Russell shared this video on Twitter during his corn harvest using a pretty cool time-lapse feature.
On Instagram, Hardwick Planting Company keeps sharing more and more harvest photos for us. Check out this awesome photo of an aerial applicator applying harvest aid for soybeans. Robert Duncan shared this video with the caption, "I can do what I love because of the people that fought and died for that flag. The least I can do is display it proudly." And you know, we've gotten a lot of great photos. I, like you, love the cotton photos. And you know who else loves those cotton photos?
Who?
The Cotton Board, because they have a photo contest going on right now. We'll post the information online, but your cotton photos could make it into their 2018 cotton calendar.
Yeah, we'll submit those and submit them to us too with mm-hmm. the Twila Harvest hashtag. And you know, harvest season is still going, so that means there's still time for you to share your harvest with us on social media and win one of our Yeti prize packs. We've got lots of Yetis, but we need more photos mm-hmm. and videos. So whether you're harvesting grain or planting cane or harvesting cane now, we want to see all of your snapshots from the field. So share those harvest photos with us with the hashtag Twila Harvest for a chance to win one of our special Yeti-themed Twila prize packs.
While we're giving stuff away, it's time for this week's Twila trivia. Last week, our question was, red and purple leaves are caused by the presence of which substance trapped in the leaf? And the correct answer is B, sugar. This week, our trivia question is, which state does not produce a cotton crop? Is it A, California, B, Arizona, or C, West Virginia? To enter this week's trending trivia contest, simply log on to your Facebook or Twitter account and post your answer with the hashtag Twila Trivia, or you can always submit your answer the old-fashioned way on our website at twilatv.org.
Well, that does it for this edition of Twila. Be sure to join us next week. We'll show you how sugarcane growers are helping to make a difference in their community.
Until then, you can watch all of our stories online at twilatv.org, and be sure to like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter and Instagram.
For all of us here at Twila, thanks for joining us. We hope to see you again right here next week.